scattered their armies for battle. They were gathered at Sokoth, which belongs to Judah, and encamped between Sokoth and Askah and Ephes Damim. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armored with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze on his legs and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear head weighed 600 shekels of iron. And a shield bearer went before him. He stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? And are you not the servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves, and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. If I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." And the Philistine said, "Today I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man that we may fight together." When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth. And if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, since he defied the armies of the living God." David said, "The Lord, who saved me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, who saved me from the hand of this Philistine." So Saul said to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried to walk in vain, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I am not used to them." So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand and chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi and put them in his shepherd's bag, in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David, with his shield bearer in front of him. When the Philistine saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field." But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine army this very day to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by the sword and spear. For the battle is the Lord's, and we will give you into our hand." When the Philistine drew near to meet David, David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Second reading, our reading from the second letter of Paul to the Corinthians. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found in our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors, and yet are true, as unknown, and yet are well known, as dying, and see, we are alive, as punished, and not yet killed, as sorrowful, yet always rejoicing, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, and yet possessing everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our affections, but only in yours. In return, I speak to you as children. Open wide your heart also. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
On that day, when evening had come, Jesus said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. Then he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I'd like to talk to you today about a man who's been called an American hero. His name is Michael Judge, Father Michael Judge. He was born in Brooklyn in 1933, and he lived in New York City most of his life. He became a Franciscan friar and a Catholic priest, and he worked in very poor neighborhoods in New York City all of his life. He was very humble, and I don't think we would ever know his name, except that on September 11th, 2001, he went into the North Tower with the firefighters and died. Some call him an American saint. That was the term that the mayor of New York, that was Rudy Giuliani at the time, used at his funeral, which was on the 15th of September. Father Michael was a chaplain to the fire department, and I think we all saw the picture of his body being carried out of the tower. I don't know that the photographer would have taken that picture if he or she had realized that Father Michael was dead, because we don't normally photograph people who have died, he looked so peaceful. His eyes were closed, and he just looked at rest. That he had died. And many people have suggested that maybe Father Michael should be considered a saint. And because he was Catholic, the Catholic Church has a process for creating saints. As Episcopalians, we just borrow Catholic saints. If they make a saint, if we like them, we take them. If we don't, we just move on. So, but they have a specific process that they have developed. One thing is a person needs to have at least two miracles attributed to them after their death. So if someone prays to someone for healing from, say, cancer or a financial disaster, and it happens, then this committee investigates, and if that is true and there's no other reason that that miracle happened, then yes, it is because of that person. So that's a minimum requirement. And then there are two traditional avenues. One is to be a martyr. So all the old guys are the martyrs. Back in the day when the Christian church was forming and trying to become itself, a lot of them were killed because they were perceived to be dangerous. So that's one way. That's the Latin term is in odium fidei, because of hatred that another has for your faith. The other way is to live a life of very obvious, strong, even heroic Christian virtue. I think someone like Mother Teresa falls into that category. Last year in July, Pope Francis created a new way to become a saint in addition to your two miracles. And this is what's called Oblatio Vitae. And this is, of course, I'm going to name the church as well. But it's just two words. This is the free offering of one's life for God. It may be for another person, but it is ultimately to God. Now, Father Michael, having gone into the towers, which are obviously dangerous, I think qualifies under this category. He was in the North Tower, the South Tower collapsed, and he was there with the firefighters, and they were trying to get him to leave. He wouldn't go. And that was when he died. So that looks like a pretty good case of Oblatio Vitae. And there are other people kind of eligible for consideration under this, in this category. There's a good list of them. And there's hope among people that maybe some of these people will be canonized as saints. And Father Michael's, you know, an obvious candidate. But he's not on the list. No one has actually formally proposed him to go into this list. Well, why not? Because he was gay. Now, he was a Catholic priest. He took vows of celibacy. So he was not practicing. And the Catholic Church has a point of view that says if you are gay and you do not practice anything related to that, any physical activities related to that, you're okay. Because you can't do that. That's bad. But just being gay is okay. And that is a step forward. For a church that I'm not meeting up on, that has been slow to recognize our humanity. Let's put it that way. And they're not alone in that. But so he should qualify in that way. But he still doesn't. He's kind of contaminated, I think. Father Michael Judge decided to become a Franciscan friar when he was 15. And he took it until age 28. He went to college, went to seminary, was ordained, was accepted as a Franciscan. They take very strict vows of poverty. They live with nothing. They do not live high on the hog. I will not mention other denominations, but if you heard the word Jesuit, some of them look pretty well. And again, no criticism, just a fact. But the Franciscans really don't take anything. They are just out there doing whatever God is calling them to do, and they live a very plain life. That's why they wear that brown habit. It's just plain brown. Nothing fancy. And he lived in New York, and he was in parish churches. But where he found his home was in a, what they call a service church. I've never heard this term before. But it's a place that doesn't have regular masses, but it's a place where people can go to talk to someone, to get help, just to escape from something terrible that's happening. A place of refuge and love and relief. That's what he did. That's where he worked at. There were other friars there with him, and they just offered whatever people needed that they could provide. And I think that was his calling, because he felt an affinity for people who were on the margins, who had no place else to go, and who were thought of as less than human, who were not loved by God. But I think he thought that that would be his life. He could be doing that. He would work out of that church, or that building, I guess. And that was sort of predictable in a way. But you don't turn your life over to God and have your life be predictable, as we all know. And even if we don't officially turn it over to God, God still has ways of making things really quite unpredictable. So he was busy ministering to, you know, the people who live on the streets in New York City. And I think we've all been there. And we know what that looks like. It's overwhelming, just because of the sheer density of population. You can't miss it. In 1981, the AIDS epidemic hit the United States. And this was a time of terror, because people were afraid. It was a new disease that had no known cure. It still doesn't. It was all over the place, and it was thought of as a gay man's disease. So the disease is spreading, and fear of gay men is spreading even faster. And that was already there to start with. So it was a really difficult time, and people with AIDS were really out on the streets, dying in great pain. So Father Michael helped create several AIDS ministries and got hospitals to create places where people could go. And all they could do was die in peace. They couldn't do anything for them at that time. But at least they could die as human beings. And when people would ask him, as they were dying, "Does God hate me?" He could say, "No. No, this isn't God who hates you. God loves you." Because we know that God is with us even in his most awful circumstances. But that helped Father Michael add yet another vocation, which was advocating for people with AIDS and for people who were gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender. People who had been othered and who still to this day are not treated as full citizens in most cases. He was a strong advocate for them. That's one of the reasons why he was having a little trouble with his canonization process. I mean, I don't think he spends a lot of time worrying about it, right? I think this is a good time to ask ourselves, why is it that people who are lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender are not treated as full human beings by society at large? I'm going to use the pronoun we to represent society, and I'm not accusing anyone. I just think it's a social construct. It's a whole group of people, and it's a good time for us to look at ourselves and ask what we are doing in this situation. But this is not an accusation. I'm trying to propose a theory for why this would be happening. I wonder if we try to create a world that we understand, a world that is predictable, so that we know how to behave. Because life is complicated. We meet new people all the time. We have new situations. We don't really always know what we're doing. And we like to have things predictable. And we know when we get up in the morning, the sun is rising in the east, and it's going to set in the west. If that didn't happen, I think we would have an existential crisis, right? We think that the summer should be hot, not too hot, and winter should be cold, there should be rain, And we know there are all kinds of things happening with the weather that we've been noticing in the last, I don't know how long, 20, 30 years. There are a lot of different theories for this, but it's very upsetting. It's upsetting because we don't have the food we need, and there are floods and all these sorts of things, but it also creates, I think, a dread of, oh my gosh, the world is changing in a way that I can't control, and what will happen to me? Will I survive? This is a survival mechanism to have a world where we know what to do. And we need that. And we construct that to the best of our abilities. We also think that there are, the people fall into two categories, male and female. And that males behave in certain ways, and females behave in certain ways, and they interact in certain ways. And we think they're predictable. We think we know everything we need to know about that. Well, and then someone comes along who has a different take on male, female, and interaction. And for some of us, it makes us fear our survival. We fear that we don't understand, and there could be some danger here. My world has turned upside down, and I don't know what to do. I wonder if that is how some people react when they meet someone who's different from them. They're different from the world they have constructed in their minds. And we all have one. So that's just my suggestion. There are a lot of smarter people out there who have better ideas. But I don't understand I'm struggling to understand this visceral response to things like same-sex marriage. If you're not marrying someone of the same gender because you don't want to, then why is it a problem if someone else does? That kind of thing. I don't understand that. Anyway, so the Bible is very aware that we create worlds of our own. And we had a fairy tale today, which it was a long reading, and thank you, Charbel, for heroically reading that very long passage about David and Goliath. That's a fairy tale. It has all the elements of a fairy tale. Have any of you, I know you're familiar with Grimm's fairy tales. Have you read the unredacted versions, the original versions, with all the it's pretty gory. okay, it's kind of like this, only, you know, fairy tales are a way that, well, we find in fairy tales, let's put it that way, a depiction of our inner landscape. What we're thinking, these worlds that we create in our heads based on what we are perceiving outside. And this is a great one, David and Goliath. This is the classic story of the young man from nowhere, David, who comes in and saves the day for the entire Israelite army by killing this huge, horrible giant, and then he gets rewarded by marrying the king's daughter. We know how well that turned out. So this is, it's a fairy tale, but it's showing us something about ourselves. So Goliath is this huge, scary guy. I don't even know if he's a guy, he's a thing, isn't he? He's this giant, he's monstrous, and he's got all this heavy, heavy armor, and this gigantic javelin. He's got somebody carrying his shield, and shields were usually the heaviest part of their armor, so we don't even care about that. He's really heavily armored, and he's out there, and he's going to kill this, well, he's going to take on the entire army. And then little David comes up and says, no, I'll do it. And Saul says, no, you're too rude, you don't know anything. But what alternative does Saul have? Nobody's exactly jumping out of the Israelite army, including Saul himself. So he says, okay, fine, I'll give you my armor. So he puts on his armor, which is pretty heavy, and here's David sort of staggering around, and he said, I can't do it with this. I gotta take this off. So he throws the armor off, and he goes and gets these little stones, because he knows how to use a slingshot. And he tells Saul, I can kill lions and tigers and bears, and I know what to do. And he can transfer that skill to killing this big monster giant. And Saul at this point doesn't want to be part of it. He's just like, please, God, let me survive. So David goes out and kills him. Boom, first time. Just, he hurls the stone, and there he goes. There's Goliath, he's dead. So what is God? Remember Goliath had all this armor on. What has died from the perspective of what does this really mean for us is the worldview has died. The worldview that everything has to be a certain way. When you fight, you've got to wear a certain amount of armor. David got rid of the armor. And he used other skills to kill this guy. Goliath was so heavily armored he could hardly move. And he couldn't even get out of the way of a stone. So what died was the perception, our perception, that the world is a certain way and that it can never change. David was very open to change. He didn't know what was coming the rest of his life, but he was there right then. He said, no, I'm not going to believe all this stuff. I'm not going to live the way we've always lived. Something new is happening, and I'm going to be there, whatever that might be. So he walks away from a fantasy and walks into reality. The reality is that we are all different in every possible way, including our sexual orientation. All of these things, we're different. But we are children of God. We're loved. And we don't need to judge people who are different from us. We just need to see, this is an interesting person. I can learn from this person. And we can live on the face of the earth together. There's nothing wrong with that. Jesus is the one who points out for us that it's fear that holds us back. In that boat, he's asleep. He is so calm, he's actually asleep. And when the disciples wake him up and say, we're drowning, we're gonna die, what's wrong with you? You don't care about us. He says, what are you afraid of? Why don't you trust me? How long have I been telling you this stuff? It's a big step. But Jesus is the one that gets us through this. He is our model, and he gives us the strength. We just have to trust him. David trusted, he wouldn't have used the word Jesus, but he trusted in God, and it worked. Father Michael trusted in God. He got into places that we would probably all be afraid to go. And he wasn't afraid. He just went. And he wasn't afraid of himself. Even though being gay is not a good thing for him as a priest. But he knew it was a good thing for him to relate to other people, to be who he was, and to accept everybody else as they were. And that's what Jesus said, you can do this. You don't have to be afraid. And Father Michael shows us how to do it. And I personally want to nominate him for sainthood. Amen.